Okay, I think we should start now. We are running late on time and others could join in between. So a very warm good evening, everyone. Good evening to Indians. Good morning and good afternoon. Thank you for joining today's meeting. I would like to welcome you all to the first session of Chem Informatics for Biomedical Data Analysis, co-hosted by Pine Biotech, Faba Academy, and partnered by Pharmatopples and Probiotechnica, supported by Schrodinger. So let me start with an introduction about us. We are a US-based bioinformatics company who is working with multiple academic and commercial collaborators to develop easy-to-use analytical tools. And our mission is to make bioinformatics more accessible. Omics Logic research-based training programs are a result of close collaboration between Pine Biotech and numerous academic institutions that have participated in content evaluation, curriculum review, and project design. Omics Logic programs follow a project-based learning approach using research-grade tools to analyze data from top peer-reviewed journals. Omics Logic training has been completed by over 10,000 participants from 162 countries in over 300 workshops for six different specialization tracks, being oncology, infectious diseases, precision medicine, neuroscience, data science of biomedical data, and comprehensive training on omics data analysis. My name is Sonalika Ray, and I'm the Omics Logic Community Manager responsible for daily interactions with thousands of users that are a part of a bioinformatics community managed by Pine Biotech. I'm honored to be working with a team that collectively has amazing experience in the area, including the other co-founders of the company, Dr. Alfred Tauber, who comes from a medical background with expertise in oncology, immunology, and biochemistry of inflammation. And one of these projects is the establishment of Tauber Bioinformatics Research Center, which has been at the core of what we do. Dr. Leonid Brodsky is the director of Tauber Bioinformatics Research Center and is an expert in bioinformatics and biostatistics. Our platform is a result of some of the experts which you see on the right. Julia Panoff, she's an expert bioinformatician and has helped prepare many of the materials that we would use. Avi Tutovsky, who is a computer scientist and leads the development of the bioinfo platform that we would be using in the course. Dr. Harpreet has an expertise in the application of statistical machine learning techniques and biomedical data and the development of prediction tools and databases and looks after the curriculum development, bioinformatics and data science course development for the company. Dr. Mohit Mazumdar is an experienced bioinformatician with multiple publications in peer-reviewed journals and collaborations in industry and academia. Over the past several years, he has been developing collaborations with universities as a mentor and a project lead for Omics Logic Training and Research Fellowship. Now, coming back to the program, this program is designed to address the challenges associated with understanding, modeling, screening, and applying cheminformatics strategies to improve drug discovery results. The process of finding a new drug against a chosen target for a particular disease usually involves high-throughput screening, wherein large libraries of chemicals are tested for their ability to modify the drug. With contributions from leading researchers in academia and biotechnology, pharmaceutical industry, as well as experts from the software industry, this comprehensive mentor-guided training program explains how cheminformatics enhances drug discovery. Now, I would like to welcome Dr. Puneet Kakkar to take over the lecture and take the session ahead. Over to you, Dr. Puneet.
Thank you very much, Sonalika. Let me know, Sonalika, if you can hear me.
Yes, sir, I can hear you.
Very good. Thank you very much, everyone, for joining this call. And thank you, Sonalika. So am I given control and I can share my screen?
Yes, sir, you can share your screen.
Okay. Let me share it. Okay, I'm little zoom, so let me know if you can see it.
Yes, sir, we can see your screen.
Very good. Thank you very much, everyone. Hello to everyone. My name is Puneet Kakkar. I am the Functional Industry Analytics Manager at Accenture in the office. And I am, by profession, I am PhD in drug discovery and been associated with multiple organizations previously before joining Accenture. I was associated with Accelera, GBK Bio in their drug discovery unit, and then Inoplexus, which is a pharma AI company based in Germany. And from last 1 year, I have been associated with Accenture. So my I have been involved in multiple roles across multiple organizations that I just mentioned it. And I have learned a couple of interesting things that I thought maybe worth sharing with all of you here. And this session would be very interesting and very hands-on as well. So I'm also looking forward to for your active participation. I am pretty sure that this session will be very helpful for you. So we will be talking about the cheminformatics as such at a broader level, and you will see some of the informations which are maybe trivial, but generally people are not aware of how the handshakes have been done, what are the businesses involved in cheminformatics, what a day-to-day activities of cheminformatician is generally a cheminformatician generally do in the lab, in their computer lab, and what is the expected output from that skill set. So I hope with this, you will learn a couple of new things and it will be helpful further for you to pursue and decide whether you want to pursue this the career in cheminformatics, and you would really love to. I believe you will really get fascinated and you will love to participate further in such conferences, and you will build more knowledge in cheminformatics. So my presentation is very simple, very general, and we'll keep it very interactive as well. We'll learn something about what is cheminformatics. You have heard so many times, possibly you have read so many times, but we'll see it what is in general terms and what these terms actually mean. Cheminformatics and drug discovery pipeline. So you have seen drug discovery pipeline several times, from starting from disease or target identification till the marketing, but where exactly cheminformatics is placed and what are the stages where cheminformatics is involved, we will see that part. Key collaborations. I mean, when you work in a scientific domain and you are hunting for the drugs, you have to really work as a team. You need to collaborate with so many people, and that's a handshake you need to do. But do you know, as a chemoinformatician, chemoinformatic scientist, what are the other handshakes you need to do it? So that part we'll discuss in third point. This is key collaboration. And collaboration, team spirit makes a successful drug, right? Then we'll see about key businesses in chemoinformatics. What are the day-to-day activities? What are the approaches, methodologies are being widely used in chemoinformatics? And what should we really learn? And why they are being used? Why one method is used rather than others, right? So that's the thing. And in the last, I will show you something which is interesting, which is very simple with the free tool, so that you all can really do some hands-on when you go back home with a lot of learning and a lot of new mind-opening things in hand. Is that okay? Let's start. So cheminformatics, sometimes you see cheminformatics, sometimes you see written as cheminformatics. Generally, these are interchangeable terms, people use it, but let's prefer cheminformatics. Chemo for chemistry, chemo for chemical compounds. Informatics is more about informatics, computer, involvement of computer technology into the chemical sciences. So by definition, it's very difficult to describe, but by definition, if you say chemoinformatics uses algorithms. So it uses algorithm means it uses computer programs. and conceptual methods related to the algorithms, often adopted from computer science. So you see, the field is interdisciplinary. It means that wherever you find publications, articles saying that, yes, there is a computer method that can solve some tricky problem of human life, people try to see whether this can be used in my chemical sciences or not, whether it can be used for my drug discovery work or not. So this is how people try to repurpose or adopt that technology, methodology, algorithm for their work to solve, right? So this is how the things are going now. One thing is discovered for something else, and now people are using it for something else. So applicability of methodology on multiple disciplines can be seen across variety of topics. And here in the computer science also, machine learning methods are not initially designed or developed for, say, chemical sciences. It was for something else, to solve somebody else's problem. But later on, people say, okay, yes, it can be utilized in chemical sciences in discovering drugs, identifying more worthy compounds for the treatment of diseases, right? So that's a thing. So cheminformatics uses algorithms and computer methods often adapted from computer science to organize and process chemical data. Whenever you see organize, it means you are dealing with something which is very large, huge. Chemical compounds is exactly of that nature. There are enormous possibilities that you can design any type of compound. Whether you can synthesize them or not, that's a different thing. But they are full of creativities. You see publications like Journal of Medicinal Chemistry and other chemistry, synthetic chemistry articles, and people are designing new chemical compounds with really nice decoration. And they are very excited about it because they are discovering something new which can be synthesizable. They don't know sometimes whether their molecules that they are synthesizing now, they are proposing now, has any value in terms of drug discovery. But later on, you never know when these molecules can be a kind of a silver bullet for a target to, act as a drug. So this is all happened. This is how the research usually goes. So to organize and process chemical data. In cheminformatics, we are focusing mostly on the chemical data. Analyze and predict. Whenever you do some processing, you need to analyze and predict, because these are simulations. The outcome should be you to predict something. I have given you a compound. Basis on your learning in the past, can you tell me whether this compound can be active for a target or not? I'm not sure whether you are very much familiar with the target as a term, but you consider it as target as a protein, a structure or a protein which is present on the cell surface, and it has some role in disease etiology or disease biology. So you want because the overexpression, the large number of proteins are expressing in your body, that's why it is creating problem. Why not you knock down them all, or at least to some extent to most of them, so that the disease can be cured or disease can be lowered and the body can become a normal healthy body. So this is how people generally say targets and the compounds, and this is all the interaction we will be talking about in all over the slides in couple of other upcoming time. So analyze, predict, structure property relationship. We'll talk about a little bit more about structure property relationship of small molecule, right? For small molecules. So everything related to small molecules. Drugs can be small molecule, can be big molecules. Big molecules, we are talking about kind of biologics, the protein, the antibodies. But we are not saying antibodies here. We are talking about small molecules. So whenever you see small molecule drug, the field is more or less is chemoinformatics you need to go. And design compound. You need not to only identify compounds. Not only you need to predict their activity, but sometimes and most of the times, in fact, you need to design new compounds which are worthy enough to be synthesized and tested in the experimental settings. What does it mean? It means that you have, a scientist has discovered a drug which is working okay for a disease, but it has a lot many side effects. So once it will be released, but later on people will start working on that molecule, saying that this molecule has some problem. It has a lot of toxicity, like chemotherapies, right? Chemotherapy agents, they are highly toxic. So people are start working on it. How can I minimize this toxicity? It's all about increasing the value of the compound by decreasing its side effects, toxicity, and a higher dose which is given to the body, all those things. You need to optimize the compound in a way that has a better drug-like properties and lower side effects and toxicity related to that compound. So just in one go, if you read it, chemoinformatics uses algorithm and computational methods, often adapted from computer science, to organize and process chemical data, analyze and predict structural property relationships of small molecules, and design compounds. So in this definition, if you see, you will be understanding that chemoinformatics is a very, very interdisciplinary field, where you need to understand some part of computational science, you need to have the understanding of algorithms, you need to see how the databases are being managed for chemical compounds, what are the small molecules we are talking about, what is their definitions, how you can design new compounds, and how you can make the compounds in terms of their, predict their activities. So all those things will be studied in chemistry. And there are multiple interesting tools available. We are equipped with them. Most of them are free also. So it's absolutely very, very interesting thing. I don't know if you can see the header, but I don't know if I can make it. Okay. So this part is showcasing you the drug discovery process. I am 100% sure you have seen such kind of images multiple times. But what you need to learn from this specific slide is, where are we talking about chemoinformatics is being used in this whole process? So let me explain you. You are starting from left and moving to the right. The initial part is the target and hit identification. We'll come to that point a little later. And we are reaching to the regulatory development. The dollars in each, above each of the section, which is target and hit identification, hit refinement, lead refinement, and regulatory development, you see the number of dollars are increasing. It means that which phase is more expensive or having a lot of cost associated compared to the other one. So it seems like companies need to expend little less on target and hit identification, relatively more on hit refinement, even more on lead refinement, and the highest in regulatory development. So this is a really, really expensive thing. What is regulatory development is more on clinical trials, and after clinical trials, approval and marketing, right? So a lot of things happens even once the drug is approved and reaches to your nearest medical store. There's a lot of money involved there as well, a lot of expenses. When we say target and hit identification, this is, you can say it's an initial step in the drug discovery process. So it's a linear process here. And it means that you identify a specific disease and also understand what is the real target, right? What is the real target you need to design the drug for? So you cannot design a drug for the whole human body. You need to see if the drug is taken by the human body, where it should go and bind. So it goes to your body, it goes to the bloodstream, it goes to the organs, it goes to these tissues, and within the tissues on cells, and on the or inside the cell, where exactly it go and bind. So it can go and bind to the receptor on the cell, it can go and bind to the free substances or the molecules in the cytoplasm, it can bind to nuclear receptors, it can bind to the DNA or something like that. All these are target, for example. So we are considering, for the ease of simplicity, we are saying, okay, protein is a target, consider, but it's not 100% true. DNA can also be a target. We are saying target identification is important because this is what that decide what do we make, what do we need to make it, how do we make it, is there any existing things available for this, where that target is involved in the disease biology. If your target is misleading, can you expect you can cure a disease? Possibly not. For example, consider a disease B can happen through two targets, T1 and T2. Consider that. And if you block target T1, will you stop the progression of a disease? Possibly not, because the same disease can be happened through a different route, which is a T2. So it means that you need to really understand pathophysiology of the disease and then understand what exactly the target you need to focus on. So that's a target identification. Once you identify the target, you screen the compounds. What is the question is, what is the initial set of compound I should work on? Right, obvious question. What is the initial set of compound I should work on? So that's a screening, we called it a screening, it's called hit identification, and we have a larger pool and multi-million compound libraries, and then we screen those libraries like a filter. You have a sieve and you are putting a lot of chemical compounds and you are doing some screening of those. Okay, with the lens, yes, this compound is looking good for this target. Okay, let's select it. This compound is looking bad, no, reject it. And something like that, you can make accept and reject for the larger pool of compounds. And at the end, you will have a smaller set of compounds, which can be used for further evaluation. We'll talk about it, what it is. So at the end of this process, you get VHS, which is a validated hit series. It means that initial testing says, yes, some sort of this type of compound, which look like this, are good for this target. Seems like they are working. Why don't we start working on that? So that's a hit you have identified. When you search the Google, for example, for any term, you see the results are coming as 100 million hits. Hit means that's the initial guess you find it out from the larger pool of, say, collection, right? That's a hit. Now, once you identify a hit, you need a better hit. Always, you need a better hit, and there are so many things because of which you need to hit. You need to refine the hit. So that's a hit refinement activity. You optimize the compound, you see a really good one, yeah? So for example, in the hit target to hit identification, you obtain 500 compounds, but you have budget only for 10 compounds to test. It means that you will put some stringent criteria, some sort of evaluation, very strict evaluation, so that you can reach out to 10 compounds out of 500. So that's a hit. That's a screening, hit refinement, you can say hit prioritization as well. Once you do that, you obtained a LSI score called lead series identified. So whatever compound you get it, you test in the laboratories and you get something which is a very promising lead compound. Lead compound is like a leader. Other compounds can follow it because this leader compound has most of the desirable properties that we are looking for a drug molecules to have it. So most of them, because that's a high affinity compound, very potentially binding very, very strongly to the target. So that's a lead series identified. And then we go for the lead refinement, which is an even more expensive thing. And you optimize the properties and test extensively in the laboratory and biological systems, right? So after the lead refinement, you get clinical candidate selection. So it's a candidate, again, it's a candidate. It's a candidate for clinical investigation. So it means that after this lead refinement, you will get a compound which should be ready for clinical trials, for clinical studies. In lead refinement, you perform the experiments on the animals. So it's a preclinical one because it's happening before the clinical phase, the preclinical and this. Now, where exactly the chemoinformatics is actually placing in the whole process, right? Where exactly this chemoinformatics can take into place. So target and hit identification, yes. Hit identification is dealing with chemical compounds. So chemoinformatics there, where you have larger pool of compounds, we'll see from where you can get larger pool of compounds. You screen the compounds against a selected target or maybe in a chemical compound-based study. We'll see what it is. You perform lead generation, that is also a chemoinformatics part. And then lead generation to lead optimization, that is also in collaboration with synthetic medicinal chemistry, pharmacology, biology, everything is involved here. So all these three phases, and you see most of this part of the drug discovery, which is early drug discovery, I would say, is involving the chemoinformatics, right? Everything that requires here requires chemoinformatics intervention extensively, and this becomes a very handy tool for other scientists in the drug discovery, while involved in drug discovery projects for leading for a drug to the market. So this is what. Now coming to next, Puneet, you said that there are multiple handshake involved. There are many people involved in identifying the compounds, identifying the right initial or starting point of the chemical compound against target. But who are the, is the chemoinformatics the only king there? Are there other people involved in it? And if there are other people involved, who are those? And how do we handshake with all of them, right? What is the connection between a chemoinformatics person and a synthetic chemist and pharmacologist and then biologist? Whether chemoinformatics anytime talk to biologists or not, and something like that in multiple exchanges or multiple network. So this slide is talking about that. Consider this, that you are working in a pharmaceutical company and you are working as a chemoinformatics person. So what is your day-to-day role here? Your project manager, okay, so the leadership in a pharmaceutical company has decided that, okay, we will work on, say, Alzheimer's disease now. Our focus should be on Alzheimer's disease because of these strategic reasons. The strategic reasons could be there's a larger population, aging population, who are really struggling a lot on Alzheimer's. There are very less drugs available who can accurately treat or give the good symptomatic relief on Alzheimer's disease. And there is a bigger market for the drug if we can crack it. So that could be the strategic reasons by which a company decide, yes, we need to work on this project. So work has been started and the project manager has been appointed. Now the project manager will decide a team with the other leadership members and the required gather information which is required, and then it will pass information to everybody in fact. But who is the starting point for this? So computational chemist would be the potential starting point here. I mean, there are multiple other people involved in it, but I'm just making it more simple from the scientific side of it. So actual start will be from a team who can identify targets and then move forward. So project information, I believe that has that information or already given that information to project manager, and they are coming to a computational chemist. Now, computational chemist is getting this information that, okay, I need to work on this target or maybe on this disease, which has some targets with the known compounds, and I need to produce some new compounds for other team members to develop for the drug. So what they will do? So computational chemist or you people at the pharma company, you will take that information and you run a bigger chemical screening from the database, and you run a lot of simulations, and then you propose some, say, 100, 500, 200, 10, 20 compounds based on the requirements of the project. So you will identify compounds that are tested in computer simulation. This is your work. What you will do next, you will hand over those compound list. I mean, how would you hand over? Because you are a computational chemist, you will provide an email, an encrypted email. You can put it on some shareable internal storage and pass on to the right people or the team. You will show it in the presentation to the synthetic chemist and the wider audience, to all of them in a meeting, saying that I have identified some promising compounds for this target that we have decided to work on. And these are the list of 10 compounds or 50 compounds. Synthetic chemist, you will say, okay, yes, this compound looks good to me. Can we purchase those compounds, or you want me to synthesize them? So computational chemist will say, okay, I have the vendor information available with me. Why don't you, if the time is a constraint, why don't we purchase those compounds directly and test it? Okay, so who will test it? Pharmacologist will test it. Who will synthesize the compound if it needs to be synthesized? Synthetic chemist will synthesize. So you will hand over the compound. They will see, okay, what is the mechanism by which they can be synthesized? What is the best route of synthetic process, and so many other things. They will synthesize and identify for the purity. So compounds are synthesized, 10 compounds proposed by computational chemist, 10 compounds have been synthesized by the synthetic chemist and handed over. How do they hand over? Because they have synthesized, they can hand over only in the physical quantity. It's not like they will send an email saying that, okay, here's the compound, you test it. No, they have synthesized the compound. It means this either in the liquid, in the powder form, some sort of physical quantity of the compound will be there. And they hand over to whom? Pharmacologists. Pharmacologists will test those compounds in the biochemical and cellular assays. Assays are something which they try to identify whether the compound has some likeness to the given target, whether this compound can really work or not. Oh, pharmacologist has tested the compound. They found, okay, your two compounds are only seems working. Rest of them are not good. So they have prioritized compound based on their in vitro assays. So they are not doing any kind of animal studies initially. They are doing only on the in vitro studies. So biochemical and cellular assays, experimental determination, and then they can have the ranking list of the compounds which are based on the activity, and then they hand over to biologist. But there could also be a chance that they have not identified anything which is worthy enough. How many compounds in the computational chemist has proposed? 10 compounds. How many compounds synthetic chemist has synthesized? 10 compounds. Pharmacologist, how many compounds they have tested? All 10 compounds. How many they found to be good enough? 0. Then they will come back saying to the company, your 10 compound proposal was really poor. What kind of models you have applied? None of them are working in my experimental settings. Can you relook at the models? Can you relook at something on your simulation? What went wrong there? So all those communications started, and there's a back and forth iteratively multiple times, and they will give the feedback. Even if there is a two compound active, they will give the feedback to the computational chemist so that they can start preparing other lead compounds and improve the activity for those compounds which are already found positive. Positive means good in activity. So two compounds. So every feedback is important. Every bit of information is very critical here. Nothing has to be considered as waste. Now pharmacologists have found two compounds which are good. They handed over two compounds to biologist. They have tested the compounds, or they have seen the better compounds iteratively from them, and they given those compounds to the biologist. If there is a desired level of activities reported, they have given to biologist. Biologist has tested in the animal system, and they found that this compound is working good in animals. Why don't we prioritize them? So based on multiple feedbacks, biologists test, talk to computational chemists, biologists also test to pharmacologists. What is your readouts? What is my readout? Whether they are saying, whether we are hypothesizing, which is a good mechanism, which is the correct mechanism of the compound, whether we are thinking the compound is working as expected. All those things, discussions are generally happen all the duration of 3 to 6 years, and be in this like $9 million estimated during the whole process. And this, after this, biologist send this compound to the clinical, compounds to the behind the management to take a further decision on the clinical trial, because these are more very competitive within the organization, and they are very strategic decisions. So this is a handshakes a chemoinformatics or other scientists do inter with other people, other scientists start on day-to-day basis on a very, very ambitious drug discovery project. Let me pause here. If you have any questions, please let me know. Okay, so let me start. So here, there are some key businesses that we see in the chemoinformatics part. So what are our key day-to-day activities? We are involved in data curation. Sometimes some companies are involved in data curation. We are talking about database creation. We also will talk about this data processing, chemical screening and structure modification, and then analysis. So multiple things within the chemoinformatics division, and each has their own set of activities. So data curation, if you are doing simulation, if you are doing anything on say AI, machine learning, or anything you are playing with the data, the important thing is the quality of the data. If the quality of data is not of good quality, you cannot expect the gold standard results out of it. So data curation makes the try to attempt to identify the the issues in the data and solve those issues through manual or automated curation. So variety of sources of chemical structures, but we need to see which one is the right source, having the right and accurate data. At the end, we believe, we consider that our data should be accurate enough and high quality enough so that we can take that data for further processing. Because you are talking about drugs, nobody wants a drug to be there are some attempts which remain to optimize the drug. Everybody wants whatever pill I am taking should be very thoughtful, stringent, scientific merits has been considered for developing that medicine. So second is database creation. So once you have a larger pool of data, you create the databases, and those databases are carefully organized, structured, so that whenever you require data, you can effectively retrieve the data related to the chemical structures. Data processing, many times you need to handle the data processing based on the requirements. For example, if you are dealing with machine learning, AI related stuff, you need to ensure that the compound should have the right properties, descriptors calculated, and that processing is required. Many times there are missing atoms and other things in the data. You need to take care of those things. Many times you use one tool and then other tool, and then in both the tools there is no sync up. Output of one cannot be used as such as input to the other one. And there are a lot of issues related to it. So data processing, format exchange, file formats, many things comes into picture here. Next step is the chemical screening and structure modification. You have the chemical library ready, which is of high quality. You have transformed the data, whichever is required, prepared everything. And now it's time for running that library against a specific target. Or you have the compounds prioritized from the initial screening, and now you want to modify the compound for a better activities, right? Or desirable properties. So all those things come into picture here. And then the analysis. Analysis means whatever you do, you need to analyze it. You need to analyze it. Without analysis, there is nothing, really nothing. You cannot consider your study, your efforts remain as such in silos without going forward for analysis, right? So analysis is also very, very critical and important. Moving next, the first part of it, the first part is data curation. You will see many, many companies who are doing data curation as well. What does this data curation actually mean? Now consider this slide. You can collect data from multiple sources, right? You can collect data from literature, you can collect data from other databases, you can collect data from direct submission, means that scientists like you around the world are submitting the data. But you have seen that even if you send a form to your friend saying, okay, I'm doing this study, which cheese in the pizza you like it, and people will write so many things in so different ways, even same thing in so many different ways, right? So in that case, your data is not normalized, or not normalized means not standardized, let's say that. So you need, the idea here is to keep the data standardized so that you can apply filters, you can screen the data, you can filter out the data based on certain properties, certain descriptors, and you can make your own subset of data so that you can use it for screening purposes. So idea here of data curation is to have a high quality standardized data set. That's the thing. Why you are doing? Because we are collecting data from multiple sources. Multiple sources have written the same thing in a multiple different ways, and there will be a lot many conflict. How do you rectify that? You need to set up a curation process which can take part of all these erroneous things and clean your data. How the chemical curation, how the data curation is done, it can be done in two ways. One is an automated way by using machine learning, NLP related stuff, technology oriented, and second is more on human manual curation. The quality of manual curation is great. However, the problem is it can be a rate limiting. It can be, you cannot scale up the way the information is coming. Thousands of publications are coming every day in the PubMed or, you know, literature databases. Is it possible that all those, everything of that can be manually curated and stored in a database? Possibly not. You really need a really, really large team. So why don't you do the automated curation? Automated curation can be done fast, but is it that accurate? No. Where the error is, even that you also not 100% sure, the quality will remain compromised. Again, remain compromised. That's a trade-off. So what people do, what's the way around, how the companies are doing it. So company will do, they will prioritize the literature. Okay, these are the world's famous 20 publishing house publishing really quality chemistry related structural information. We will store those in our database only. We'll not consider rest of them. Okay, so this is how people consider it and prioritize for the screening. So curation efforts are required to address the associated issues and to ensure that the created data set is of highest quality and meets the intended requirements for screening. Fair enough? So that's the data curation. Many companies are doing that. What is that next? It's chemical databases. So chemical databases, there are many databases, as you've seen in the previous slide also, there are databases. So you are pulling the data from another databases also. In fact, these databases are collecting information from so many hundreds of other databases. So that is also possible. And this is what is happening. If you have heard the name of PubChem, Campbell, DrugBank, Zinc, and PDB, probably you have seen they are very, very good and standard databases, but still you cannot compare the fields that the values which are listed in PubChem and Campbell and DrugBank, you will find some differences, and that's a very, very tricky thing to handle it. So idea here is you stick to some of them. Campbell is also manually curated one, as has activities reported for the compound. It means that experimental activities which are published in the publications, they are reported there. So very, very famous databases, a lot of hard work behind the creating those databases, maintaining those databases, and each database has their own different objective. PubChem stored larger number of chemical compounds ever synthesized or known to them. That's why you have a really, really large number here, 110 million. You have Campbell, which is 2.1 million compounds, and they have activities reported for the compounds, which is a lesser one. Zinc and DrugBank. So I'm sorry, it seems like this has been swapped. So the DrugBank has only 12,000 compounds, and PDB has, which is primarily a macromolecular structure database, it's not a ligand or a compound database. You can extract the compound from the structures, but that's fine. But it has its own value, and chemoinformatics relies on PDB a lot because of the structures of the targets. So multiple databases are available. Different databases have different objectives to store the data. Mostly we fetch list of compounds with desired properties. We'll show you one of the cases here. And synthetic feasibility of the compound is very, very important here. It means that what I need. So your manager said that, or my manager said that, let's say that, we need bring me 100 worthy compounds. Okay, dear sir, this is 100 compound list, very, very promising. Okay, he set up the call with synthetic chemist. Synthetic chemist said, none of these compounds can be synthesized. They are just like very hypothetically produced compounds. So where our study will go in that case? If your synthetic feasibility of the compound is not good or is not possible, or you have not taken that into consideration, how would you move your study further? The idea here is whatever you propose can be synthesized, so that it can be developed as a medicine. If the initial stage is so much problematic that you cannot synthesize a compound, there is no meaning of proposing that fascinating, hypothetically beautiful compound. That is absolutely not required. So vendor information in the database is important, and it provides a lot of useful information that this compound can be purchased or synthesized or not. So if the vendor is having that compound can be purchased from there, it means it can be synthesized. But obvious, right? It's a very obvious thing. Now, data processing. So once you have collected the data from databases, or you have synthesized by your own, or you have basically you have a proprietary internal data bank, you need to prepare the data. So based on the method of choice, you need to prepare data accordingly. For example, if you are doing machine learning based method, you need to generate some properties of the compounds. For example, generate descriptors properties here. If you are using molecular docking based studies, then you need, for example, you need to prepare compounds based on assigned charges. You need to do possible tautomers identification, stereoisomers, right protonation state, etc. And you can use filters, for example, Lipinski rule of five, where you have these four things in that specific values. So for example, all the compounds which has hydrogen bond donors less than equals to 5, log P less than equals to 5, and something like that. So those considerations you can take to have the initial set of compounds, and you can prepare the compound accordingly. At the same time, you also need a target structure in some of these studies, and those target structures also need to be prepared. For example, you need to see whether the target can be taken as such, or you need to complete the missing atoms in the target. You need to add hydrogens if there are, hydrogens are missing because of crystallographic experimental methodologies, assigned charges, assigned protonation state, and complete other, missing things, and make the structure whole, because you want to consider that wherever you think the compound should go and bind should have all the atomic level details available, right? Then only your prediction, your simulation can be successful, otherwise not. So this is the thing. Now, another thing is you have prepared the compound, but for what? You have curated the compound, you have collected it from databases, you have prepared it for charges, complete atoms and not, but for what? Because you want to screen the compounds. How many compounds? Millions of compounds. Can you really do it? Yes, you can do it. And this is how people do it. Because of the higher capacity or efficiency of computational methods, nowadays screening of millions of compounds are possible. And that's called virtual chemical screening. Why it is virtual? Because you are not using physical compounds for screening. You are using virtual compounds. It means that they are digital copies of your compound. But are they really virtual? No. They are virtual in the sense that how you are handling them. But actually, they can be synthetically feasible, right? Consider that point. They should be synthetically feasible compounds. Okay. What is the method should I use? There are multiple things. Broadly, the whole methodology of chemical screening can be divided into two parts. Broadly, it is ligand-based screening, and second is the structure-based screening. The ligand-based screening is on left-hand side, the structure-based is right-hand side. So you have the input, which is a chemical library, which is a list of compounds. What do you need to do? You need to screen, but which methodology? Either ligand-based or structure-based, or a combined ligand and structure-based. That is also possible. This is how people improve the quality of the results. And then you produce some output. The output is analyzed with visual inspection, and this is how people rank the molecules and prioritize the compound for further development. But what is ligand-based? Ligand-based is something which is where the analysis is completely based on set of compounds. There's no structural information of the target is considered. Now, what does it mean? Consider a case where you have taken the Alzheimer's disease into account. You have identified a target for, which is a new target, by the way, from say genomics study. And you find that this target should be considered as a potentially novel target for Alzheimer's disease. That's fine. But you don't have the structural information. Whatever you see is this compound comes from the, say, protease family, for example. What you will do, because it is completely coming from protease family, I can say, take those compounds which are already acting as a protease inhibitor. Consider that. So you have some set of previous information of protease inhibitor, but you don't have the exact structure of this target. So what you'll do, you can take the set of compounds which is available, already available to you, and then you will run the screening based completely out of chemical compounds. So generally, in most of the cases, these compounds, known compounds, have the known activity for those for the targets, basis which we try to generate the model that what should be the new compounds which should shortlist, and they can also act on that target, right? So given a target name, but not the target structure, given the known set of compounds with activities for the target, that is also fine. So that's a given set. Based on the known set of compounds, you train your model, you run some computer simulation, and then you find it out what is the new set of compounds we should also test against them. Okay, so that's a ligand-based screening, and you have the approaches like substructure search, pharmacophore search, QSAR-based search, atomic properties-based search, and you have also obviously machine learning-based method, which is somewhat utilized in QSAR also. So ligand-based approaches use a knowledge of molecules that bind to the biological target of interest, a method of choice when target structure information is incomplete or not known completely. In that case, it can be used. A structure-based approach, in other words, you have the chemical compound library you want to screen, you have the known structure of that compound, and then based on the target and the compound library, you can perform some very special molecular docking based simulation to identify whether which of those compounds can bind on that particular target. Fair enough. Whatever results you see, they can be seen in the tool at the visual inspection, and then you try to identify. Now, a little bit more in detail, why do we need so many methods for screening? So we mentioned about substructure search, similarity search, we said about molecular docking, and then QSAR. What are the questions are being asked in each of them? What is the model we are generating, and what is the query that is required? For example, let me read it one. Molecular docking. The question here is, which molecules in a database can fit into the binding site of the known enzyme or receptor? So it means that you have the given structure, you know the binding site of it, And what you don't know is the which compound is good for that particular binding site. So what you do, you will perform molecular docking exercise. Which model you use? Compounds that have a high interaction score are likely to bind to that. You can consider as a friendship. If the compound is having a strong friendship with the target, it's a good to go compound with that target. So atomic level structural receptor and model built from homology modeling and other ab initio methods can be used for this purpose. Likewise, you have questions, model and queries for each of them. So I have some hands on those. So that's just, let me go a little faster here. Now, during the discovery phase, you always require structure modification. The pharmacologist can say, yes, two compounds out of 10 seems good, but can you improve their activities? Can you modify, can you generate a better series of those compounds so that we can have a better activity of the compound? It means what? You are playing with a larger pool of chemical compounds, or you are modifying chemical compounds in a way that it can improve the properties of the compound. What kind of properties are we talking about? We always optimize two things in the compound. One is potency or selectivity for a given target. You don't want to place a lock which can be opened from multiple keys, right? Right? You never want it. That's the same way. We don't want our compound can go to multiple targets. We want our compound to be as selective as possible in most of the cases. So potency and selectivity of a given, for a given target protein. Second is ADME toxicity. My compound is very good, but it's too good for the toxicity as well. So it means that if a person is not getting cured from the existing disease, but is being died because of the toxicity, is not a good molecule. So in this case, it means that you need to minimize the toxicity, improve the favorable absorption, distribution, metabolism, and excretion properties, and improve the selectivity and potency of the compound, right? So that the minimum dose, less frequency of the dose is required for the patient to take the pill with minimum side effects, right? So who determines or what determines the overall properties of the compound? The structural properties are the fundamentals. You see on the right-hand side figure. The structural properties like molecular weight, hydrogen bonds, lipophilicity, polar surface area, pK, shapes, and reactivity. These structural properties are fundamental for the compounds. When these properties interact with the physical environment, they are making the physicochemical properties of the compound, means solubility. They determine the physicochemical features like solubility, permeability, chemical stability. When these structural properties meet the protein, then they become the biochemical properties like metabolism, transporter affinity, binding, and target affinity. When biochemical properties and physicochemical properties interact with the living system, they become the pharmacokinetics and toxicity at a broader level. You will heard the pharmacokinetics as like a clearance, half-life, bioavailability, or the bigger terms. But what is basically determining these? Fundamentally, the structural properties. So structural properties are the very key and fundamentals. How the change in the structure can determine the properties? See the left-hand lower side image where a hypothetical structures and modifications are given. And what you are seeing is changing at this place as ethyl, phenyl, methyl. These are changing the activities. What is changing the metabolite stability, metabolic stability? What is changing the solubility? These are changing in this order they are changing. So what do you really want to optimize in this molecule? You'd need to play a lot on these properties. And this is a very, very iterative process and requires a lot of knowledge and dedicated efforts, right? So this is what we generally do as a chemoinformatics. once you identify the compounds and play with the compounds, you have the always need to do analysis. Most of the times analysis is on the structure base, where you see the compound, how the compound is getting docked or docking of the compound, where it determines the overall orientation, position and binding conformation of the molecule within the protein binding site. You see the surface representation here is the protein. This ball and stick representation of your drug molecule or a potential drug candidate. And this compound is how it is fitting, how it is making the interaction is shown here, not the same compound though, is shown here, where you see this compound is a drug molecule and the dotted green lines, if you can see it clearly, they are hydrogen bonds and hydrophobic interactions are given here, how this is interacting with the surrounding residues of the protein. Other parameters of analyzing is what kind of library you are generating, what kind of activities they have it reported, either it's a predicted activities or the actual activities, and what kind of descriptor or properties of the chemical compound. These are the various superficial and very, very interesting analysis a cheminformatics person usually do in the laboratory on day-to-day basis. Now, let me know if you have any questions so far. Any questions so far? Don't say you are not able to hear me.
We can hear you, sir. I request all the participants, they can unmute themselves and take the questions.
Okay. May I ask like a question, sir?
Yeah.
Thank you so much for your good presentation first. So I do have a question regarding like new drug candidates. So you have mentioned like some of the drug properties are can be changed by modification of the structure, such as like adding some methyl groups or OH groups or like etc. So can like how do we know like if we did such modification it will improve the drug activity or not?
Yeah.
Do we need like to go for literatures or do we have something else?
Very good questions. So thank you very much for your appreciation. Multiple methods are there based on the existing knowledge. That is one thing. You have computer tools also that can predict the activities. Or, for example, if you want to minimize the toxicity, you have the softwares available who can predict the toxicity. So I can show you in one of the exercises also, though it was not planned, but I can show it to you how the modification in the structure can do the change in the toxicity or absorption, distribution. All those things can be determined. But final testing is always in the experimental setting. Who can confirm is the only experimental setting. What you can leverage the information is from the literature. It's from your previous experience. It's from your live projects you have done previously. It's from talking to your peers. It's talking from your scientists who have done multiple things, tons of projects, or tons or handles tons of those modification in the past. So they are very, very rich knowledge, experienced people. Always talk to them. Always discuss these things. And literature is always a good thing. You will see a lot of ample good information available that what people have done previously to change that part and how they have improved. And there are very standard rules also available for those things. Okay. Any more questions? So I have a very interesting exercise for all of you. I don't know how you will do it now, but I would say, just see what I am doing. Just see and imbibe that information as much as you can so that you can learn and when you reach home or when you do by yourself, you should be able to do it. It's a fairly very simple exercise. Consider a hypothetical case. Your manager has come to you. You are working on a laboratory, and in your laboratory, you were doing some work, and your manager has come to you, or a synthetic chemist has come to you. Hello, this compound I screened and in one of my biochemical assays and found very promising for this particular target. Can you tell me what is this compound? So you have the compound structure known to you, and what's the information that a scientist looking is, what is that compound? Can you provide more information of this compound? Second question. Third thing is, can you optimize this compound so that I can have a better series of this compound? Considering that if this compound is active for my target, maybe a slight modification of compound a slight modification derived from this compound is even more active. That is also possible, right? So can you do all those things for me? So how would you do it? We will be using two tools here. One is the web-based PubChem, and second is the Data Warrior. This is a very fantastic tool available free of cost for all of you. And for all of you means for all of us, for the whole world. Thanks for the developer. And you can really do that. So let me proceed with this exercise. What you will do, you need a platform where you can search this compound. We have talked about something like a substructure similarity search. It means that if I have given this, I have been given this compound, if I search the database and I identify this is an exact compound, I should get a 100% match, right? So what I have done for the ease of doing it here, instead of sketching, I have a single line notation. It's called INCHI notation for this compound. I can show you how you can, where you can make it. So we'll go to the PubChem. Let me know if you can still see my screen, right? I am typing something like PubChem. I hope you can see my screen, not the presentation. Can anybody confirm you can see the browser?
Yes.
Okay, yes, sir, we can.
So you go to the homepage of PubChem, which is the NCBI website. And if you scroll down, you will see multiple options. Go to the draw structure. Okay, I left click it. And then you will see a window will pop up. Here you see a whiteboard where you can draw the chemical compound from here. For example, this. Okay, this. And then you can build this compound without any breaking. If you break the compound, it will be a wrong molecule. So try practicing it, but for the sake of time, I will select, instead of SMILE, I'll select a standard INCHI, which I have already noted it down. I will tell you the secret from where I get this. So I have pasted the INCHI and hitting the enter. Now you see the compound has come here. This is a single piece of compound. I will say, okay, let's search this compound into the database. Okay, so it's fast enough. It's searching the database, which has 110 million compounds. Oh, it identifies the compound. This compound is nothing but a warfarin, which is a blood thinner given in multiple heart related post-heart related open heart surgeries. So as a medicine to the patient. So this is a compound. Okay, yes, this is a compound. I can see the entry and you see a lot, many information associated with this compound on the right-hand side. You see, it's a full of information. If I start speaking on this, it can take the whole day, believe me. So what you need to do, just go and search it and read a little bit about it. It's a very, very useful information source and you can get a lot of good information about it. Okay, but my manager has asked me, what is that compound? I got the answer. This is a warfarin, dear. This is a warfarin. Now he's asking me, इसका सेकंड क्वेश्चन वाज कैन यू जनरेट अ न्यू कंपाउंड फॉर इट. ओ हाउ कैन आई जनरेट इट, आई एम नॉट अ मेडिसिनल केमिस्ट. यस यू कैन स्टिल डू दैट बिकॉज यू आर अ केमो इन्फॉर्मेटिक्स पर्सन. सो हाउ वुड यू डू दैट, लेट्स गो टू अ डाउनलोड ऑप्शन और यू कैन सी डाउनलोड हियर. लेट मी सी, इट विल कम अप विद सॉर्ट मल्टीपल थिंग्स. I can download 2D structure, which is a file format, or say format for representing two-dimensional structure of the chemical compound. I can say STF is a standard format. I can save it. This is a STF format, and I have already saved this in one of the folder, which is I created a cheminformatics here. So this is I already downloaded it today. Okay, what's next? I need to generate multiple new compounds using this compound. Okay, so I have another very good tool which is called Data Warrior. I can show you the website here, Data Warrior. Okay, here's the Data Warrior. You get to open molecules, and this is a very, very very good tool for chemoinformatics purpose. You can do a lot of interesting things. See, user manual and download is all there. So yeah, the Linux, Mac and Windows, thanks to the developer. So here is the tool. I have opened this tool, Data Warrior. This is a black screen, which means that nothing is being loaded till now. I can go to file, open, and I will browse that file that I have it on desktop, the cheminformatics folder, and this one. Now this file will be loaded into the software called, yes, this is a tool. There's a right, this is the same compound. Yes, if you can identify, it's the same compound. Oh, how can I minimize this? Okay, let's go this way. If I can show it to you, that's the same compound. Yeah. So what I will do, it has a very good. So select this compound, left click, go to chemistry, generate, build evolutionary library. So first, second, third, fourth button from the chemistry menu button. Select this compound, browse this compound from the STF file that we have downloaded from PubChem. Chemistry, build evolutionary library. A pop-up will come. It will show you multiple compounds. We don't need it. Select first generation is the selected structure. So your compound has come here. Okay, and then you need to say generations. There's a lot of theory behind it. So it's a evolutionary library, the way evolution has happened, multiple generations. I can keep it simple, say generate for 50 generation, 120, say 32 compounds, and select only 8 compounds per generation, right? So 50 multiply by 8, number of compounds you will get in the final output. So 8 criteria is okay, structure. I want some similar structures for this. So add criteria and it will select selected structure. Okay, so selected structure, this is the criteria. Compounds, create compound which are drug-like compounds. And you need to watch my screen carefully here. And when I will click okay, you will be amazed to see what will happen. What we are doing here, we are going to generate new chemical compounds basis this compound. Okay. Let's see. 1, 2, 3, start. What is happening? It is automatically generating compounds, which is a slight modification of that compound basis what the rule we have provided to it, and smart enough to generate compounds. Mm-hmm. Okay, keep modifying the compound, keep generating the compounds. I am all liking it. 24 generations have already passed, 28, 29, 30. I think we have kept it for 50 generations. So let's wait till then. I can stop any time, but I want all the generations to be completed because fast enough. And you see, hundreds of compounds are being generated in a fraction of minutes. Wow. You have all the compounds here. Let me close this so that you can see the list of compounds. Wow, you have a really, really long list of compounds, right? All list of compounds, okay. Okay, now the second question was this, to generate new compounds. So I have generated new compounds. Calculate some of the structural properties. So one question was, how can we estimate the activities or the pharmacokinetic properties or basis of structural properties or structural modification? So here's the option where you can go to the, so now you see only, let me clean it a little bit more so that you can see only relevant fields. Let me go to the data, delete columns, and let me delete everything other than a structure. So please note that you should not delete the structure, otherwise you will not left out with anything, right? It's clean enough. Now I will identify or calculate some of the properties from chemical structure. I am calculating properties. You can do a lot of stuff here, very cool stuff, but let's go with the properties. And you have toxicity, shape, atom count, ring count, functional group. You can modify functional group and see whether this functional group is present in that or not. That could be one of the criteria that, okay, I need that compound which has only the sulfur, or at least have sulfate or sulfide, something like that. All those things you can identify and do that. So we are calculating, say, average molecular weight, C log P, hydrogen by acceptor, donor. Let's calculate topological surface area and see whether they are drug-like or not. Let me see. Oh, it is calculating so fast. Wow. You have all the compounds with all the desired properties noted here, right? So everything is just there. The same way you can see whether the compound have toxic element also or not. Let's see whether any compound is mutagenic, tumorigenic, reproductive effect, irritant, something like that. You can do a lot of things. Hoping it will not take much time. So with this, you can identify compounds which are really bad compounds. So you cannot propose, you should not propose those compounds while handovering these compounds to your manager, right? Or to your manager, or say your colleague, a synthetic chemist, or your counterpart from the experimental settings. So all these things you can do with this exercise, and there's a lot of fun, a lot of analysis, and really cool stuff with chemical compounds and structures. I can show you one more thing on that with the protein data bank, and you see that is the list here with me, and whether this compound has anything. Wow, you have so many compounds which are having tumorigenic properties, right? You certainly want these compounds to be not considered, right? All those compounds to be deleted. See, such a dangerous compounds, mutagenic, tumorigenic, reproductive effects. So these compounds should be deleted, should not be used. And this is how you prioritize the compounds with multiple descriptors and those. This is a lot of things. I hope you find this exercise interesting and important for you to proceed. And I could justify just 1.5 hours to make you that this is a good science, this is a beautiful science, and you can safely invest your significant amount of time learning this, and it has, you will really have a bright future here. One important database, I have so many things to show, but due to paucity of time, we are on top of the hours. And so this is a protein data bank. You just go to one of the data, for example, 1W51, and you can do a lot of stuff without even downloading any software or databases. But this is the really cool stuff in the structure-based drug design, in molecular docking exercise we will do in the upcoming sessions. We will be seeing molecular docking and playing around with the structures to some extent, and you can really rotate the molecule and see when you take the drug where it goes. It goes into the protein and binds to a specific place in the protein, and that's why your molecule really works, right? So this is how we analyze, see the interaction with the compound. In one of the slides in the analysis, I said that interaction is important, and that's our day-to-day activity as well. So all those stuff comes into the part in the chemoinformatic person's bucket. I hope that is interesting. This session, I believe, should be as beautiful as this protein, and wishes you all the best. If you have more questions, please let me know. Session is open for questions or any other discussions. Thank you, everyone.
So we have a question. Bibik asks, is there any particular software for it? For which? That's why you're asking, Bibik. Yeah. Can you please specify? Yes. You can unmute yourself, Bibik.
Thank you. Just recently, where the structural analysis was done and different drugs, different structures were analyzed for that.
So toxicity, there are multiple softwares available, freely available tool. I just show it to you. You can browse it. There are some free web-based services also available. You can look into it, Google it, and see what is the standard software. So best method to identify the right software is look at the literature. That's the best thing. Literature, what the literature said. You type, go to the PubMed and say drug toxicity prediction, or maybe software, just term software, and search for the article. See the recent article, what they have used, which web server they have used, how they interpreted the result. One toxicity tool cannot be good for every kind of toxicity. So toxicity can be of several types, right? Mutagenicity, reproductive, retained. Some are good for some field, some are good for another field. I would say the best methodology is look at the publication and go for it.
Lewis asked, would you mind showing us an example, like a paper or something like this related with discovering new purposes of drugs with this method? So Lewis, I think we would be taking all these things in our sessions, because we won't be able to cover everything in just one session. Right, Puneet, sir? Can we take this?
It will take some time. We can do drill down on the upcoming sessions, and there are several interesting sessions coming in on the way.
So Lewis, we'll take it then. I'm just sharing my screen quickly, and I'll take you through the process. So those who are new today here, I request them all to just sign up to our portal on the learn.omicslogic. If they have done so, it's great. But if they have not, then please go to the portal and sign up. I am already logged in to my account. I need to do that. Yes. So once you log into your account, you would have the program pages. And once you go to this is the way where you sign up. You can sign up using your mail ID and password. We don't recommend that you sign up using your social accounts because that somehow creates an error in the backend. So please enter your mail ID and create a password for you and just sign up. Once you sign up, you would get the program pages. Going to the program pages, you would have all the programs which are ongoing and the upcoming ones. And there you will get the program Cheminformatics for biomedical drug discovery. Once you are on the program page, you will have the access to all the sessions and the recordings of each and every session for the program. Now, it would have the access. You would have the access only if you are a part of the program. So all the participants, they can see the video of each and every session after the session is completed in the program page. And also you would be able to see each and every session detail, what session would be covered, what topics would be covered in each session, on which date. All the details are mentioned here. And if you want to now register yourself for the program, then you can do so with the same program page. So this program page is really important for us. I'm sharing the link with you all. Then you choose the level for which you would want to enroll, the beginner, intermediate, or advanced level. Now this level segregation is based on the provisions which you would be getting. And once you choose the level with which you would want to enroll, you can just check out. And while you check out, you have to use the promo code, which I have already mailed you all, and then proceed further. Now, there's a request. If someone misses out on any of our email, but you are expecting one, like I just mentioned regarding the promo code, please check your promotional boxes, because we are seeing this thing that our mails go to the promotional box because of the mass mailing concept. And you would be able to find one, and then you can proceed further with it. If you have any doubts, you can mail me at marketing@pine.bio, or you can mail Dr. Mohit at mohit@pine.bio, and we would be happy to assist you with each and every step. And before I end this session,
so Sonalika, I just have to make another announcement here that we will be sending the list of participants to Schrodinger for the 2-day workshop on Saturday and Sunday. That will be a full day, 2-day workshop on their entire platform, learning from the very basic to advanced molecular dynamic simulations and all of that. So I think those who are interested should be finalizing their registrations today, because we will be sending them the list, and also the promo code will be expiring today. So please finalize your registration so that we can send the request to with your email address and your name to Schrodinger to have your cloud platform login on the platform as well, on their platform. So because we will be utilizing the login, and you will be able to do the hands-on sessions via that. So if you don't share those details, we'll not be able to have the hands-on session. So please finalize that and kindly share. If you finalize your registration, we'll be adding you to the list, and we will be sharing that list to them tomorrow morning. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Dr. Mohit. So I'll be sending out the details of all the links which are important for the session, and those who want to register themselves, I'll be sending out the registration link and the code as well. And before ending this session, I would like to thank Dr. Puneet. It was a really very interesting session. Even I myself, like, I got engrossed in the session too, and it was so full of good information, and I hope it helped you all learn a lot about different sorts of things and got it all streamlined. And anyway, I request you all to please clear your doubts, because we have such an expert on board with us, and it would be a pleasure to clear your doubts. That was all for today, and we would be looking Sonalika, forward to... Yes, sir.
I would like
Hello, Dr. Sujit. How are you?
Hi, Sonalika. I'm doing good. Hello everyone, this is Dr. Sujit Tangadpalliwar. Guys, like today's session, we have several more sessions on the board for the entire this project, this coursework timeline. So I would request all of you to register along with Dr. Puneet Kakkar. We have several industry experts from USA and from Germany. So they'll be also helping you out chemoinformatics or a drug discovery in specifically focused on an industry point of view. So you'll learn many things, what exactly industry is working on a drug discovery area, how industry files the patent, how industry works on an IND, how people are how lead optimization, molecule heat identification, everything is happening in industry. So you will learn many things into this session. So I would request all of you to register if you have not registered yet. And it may be also, you know, helpful for your career or maybe for your research work as well. So I'm fine, Sonalika, you can take it over.
Thank you so much, Dr. Sujit, for sharing this piece of information. So I'll mail you out all the details and sorry, I was on mute. Yes, thank you so much to Dr. Sujit for sharing this information with us. And I've shared our LinkedIn page link with you. So you can join our LinkedIn page and stay updated with all the session details as well and all the upcoming sessions and the programs which we would be having. So see you all in our next session. That would be on 17th of June. Thank you for joining. Take care, everyone. Bye-bye.
Thank you, everyone. Bye-bye.